Well, it is New Year's Eve, so we thought it would be a perfect time to talk about the world of wine. We could do that with Judd Wallenbrock. He's a chief executive officer of C. Mondavi and Family. That's the parent company of Charles Krug, joining us on the phone from Napa, California. Judd, thanks so much for joining us, and happy New Year's Eve. Give us a sense of how your business was impacted by this pandemic in 2020.
Well, that's a how long do we have? Actually, you know, to be honest with you, the industry in general is sort of, it's agricultural based, right? So we're always used to the whims of Mother Nature, other things that are going on. It's not just the pandemic. We were also ravaged by fires again this year. But this is an incredibly resilient industry, and I think farmers in general have a much more positive attitude always about the future. So realistically, we definitely had to make some changes in the direction we went, but frankly, we're also deemed an essential industry. So pretty much all of our production, farming, et cetera, was all going full steam. The only thing that we really had to shut down was tastings at the tasting room in the winery, which is a small percentage of the revenues of the company. And then, of course, the biggest and hardest hit part of it was that we sell our wines a lot to restaurants. And as you know, restaurants virtually shut down at a huge level for the course of the year. Many of them, unfortunately, will never reopen, and that had a dramatic impact on sales. But of course, then we just look for other channels and re-up the ante in other locations to try and compensate for it. Now, we never compensated for it completely, but frankly, we did a pretty good job of getting back to where we needed to be.
All right, talk to us about the kind of, from your business, primarily restaurants versus retail. Is that what I'm understanding?
No, it's actually a little bit of the reverse. It's in total, our business is about 2/3 what we call off-premise, which is retail.
Okay.
And on-premise, which would be the restaurants, the hotels, catering, all those other things where they're sold on the premises themselves, that is about 33% of our total business.
So overall wine consumption, it's my understanding that overall wine consumption was up and maybe up materially in 2020, and resulting in part from the pandemic. Do you expect that to hold? How are you guys thinking about just overall consumption in 2021 and beyond?
Well, I'll answer that in two parts. One is that if you take a look at just the United States, we are really not a consumer of wine. Our per capita consumption is hideously low, particularly when you're talking about the rest of the world. We're at maybe just under 3 gallons per capita. If we go to Europe, we're talking 15, 16, 17, 18 gallons per capita. So, you know, we're just scratching the surface of culturally where we could be. And in fact, I think one thing that a lot of people don't know is that about 30% of the wine we consume in the United States is imported from outside of the United States. So if we wanted to only drink domestic wine, we wouldn't be able to produce enough to satisfy the demand, because we only export about 5%. So simple math is we're about 25 points differentiation going on there. So, I mean, I think from that one part, culturally, we have just nothing but upside when it comes to more and more people enjoying wine. Now, the second part of the answer that I will give you is that in our particular case, our company, we recognize that it's pretty competitive out there. And so the second the pandemic hit, we immediately started looking at ways to take market share, because we knew that a lot of people were going to be sitting back and just, well, let's see what's going to happen now. Let's hunker down. Let's, kind of keep everything close to the vest. Well, we went on the attack, and I think that tactic worked well for us, because we got ourselves repositioned and positioned even deeper in the retail environment, the grocery chain environment, the club environment, all the places where people were buying. So I think what we've done is we've firmly established ourselves in those channels very well. But ultimately, the consumption of wine is pretty stable. It's pretty flat right now, and it has been flat overall for a little while now.
You know, what I've noticed in this pandemic as it relates to purchasing wine, I'm doing it online now, and I don't think I'm the only one. Talk to us about how that's changed, the wine business here in 2020.
Well, yeah, you're not alone. Let me just tell you that. Everybody's buying online, and they're buying online at a couple of different levels, too. It's not just coming to our website and buying our wines from us, but it's going to third-party websites such as wine.com and some of the goes through another distribution structure to get to it. Lots of business online, and I think that's here to stay. I think one of the things that the pandemic and the fires and everything else, where you couldn't travel and you couldn't come to the wineries, you really did turn to the internet, and what that's done for our industry is sort of upped our game. We've had to become better at it. We've been sort of slow to adapt. We've got to slow to adapt everything in the wine industry. Now we're really accelerating and taking advantage of channels, using technology, becoming much smarter on how we use Google Analytics and tapping into potential buyers at more of a, let's say, a rifle shot rather than a shotgun blast.
Right, and we see more and more stories, I guess, of people maybe drinking more wine. Are you finding that they're experimenting? Are they, and what price points are they drinking? How has that maybe changed kind of your positioning in the marketplace?
Right, yeah, people are drinking up. I'll tell you the term that I use for wine in general is it is sort of the affordable luxury. Right. It's one of those things that when economic times are down, people still drink. They may not go to Hawaii. They may not, put in a new kitchen, but they're still, darn it, they're going to have their glass of wine every night.
Yep.
And that's currently what's going on now, too. People are drinking regularly. They're drinking up in price a little bit as an average. And when you're shipping wine, people definitely buy wine that's a higher price point. And the reason for that is really simply because it's very expensive to ship. And when you're buying a bottle of wine, it costs just as much to ship it as it is for the bottle of wine. You tend to actually buy a higher level of wine, higher priced.
Yeah, you mentioned earlier the fires here. And, here on the East Coast, we saw the video, and it just looked, tragic and just epic in proportions. For those of us, that don't follow the industry, maybe just give us a sense of what happened and how did it impact your area of the world there in Northern California?
Well, the fires now have become a regular thing. I think really 2008 was when we really first started getting some fires. And then it wasn't until 2016 where we've had fires in 16, 17, 18, 19, and now 20 all in a row. And each one has progressively gotten to be bigger and bigger and bigger. In 17, we thought we had the biggest fire in California history, only to be surpassed the next year. And then this year, we had about California had about 4 million acres burned in California. And that's just a ton of land. To put that in perspective, though, if you recall, just half a year earlier than that, Australia had about 40 million acres that were being burned. To put that into perspective, it's really gigantic down there. And what it really has done is it's changed how we not so much how we farm, but it's certainly how the most important thing we work on is really our employees, our staff, and then the visitors. We want to make sure that everybody's healthy. So health and safety is the number one concern when it comes to that. Can they breathe? We're not going to put them out in the vineyards if there's too much smoke. The second concern, is for the crop. And are the grapes being impacted? And will that end up resulting in a wine that has, something that isn't a desirable characteristic to it? So there's a lot of things moving around on it, but I think primarily it's everybody, I hate to use the term, but we're all burned out on fires, right?
Yeah.
It's time where we need to start doing something about mitigating the fires before they happen, not reacting to them afterwards. And I think that's going to take a real concerted effort of politicians, of environmentalists, of landowners, of just citizens in general, and we got to start moving on that pretty fast.
Has there been any indication over the last several years since 2008, when the fires really started to ramp up, that it has impacted the region's wines in terms of taste?
So far, in 2008, that really happened in Sonoma County and Mendocino County. And fortunately, that didn't really affect Napa at all. Napa is a very small area, by the way. I don't know if you know this. It's only about 4% of the total production of California wine, which is about 90% of the country's wines. But Sonoma was really impacted then. And it depends on when the fires hit. Those fires hit in July and August, which is prime time for the maturation of the grapes. They're literally breathing through their leaves, and therefore it comes into the grapes. The last couple of years, the fires have been a little bit later, so that now the plants have already started, the vines have already started to die off, and all their energy is going to the grapes, not in the respiration. So honestly, 2017, we thought we were going to have some terrible problems with what they call smoke taint, and we've found none. And so we've been very, very fortunate. The wines are tasting great. Crack open a bottle of 17 Cabernet from Napa, and you'll see what I'm talking about. So now what we're really doing now is we're waiting until about February. The wines are going through a fermentation right now, and when that secondary fermentation comes through, we'll know if we've got any problems with the wines. But so far, preliminary indications are no problems, at least with our wines. There are definitely some people who weren't as lucky, I think, who were up further up the valley where the smoke was much worse.
All right, Judd, give me a recommendation for a Cabernet for tonight, a Charles Krug Cabernet. What should I be opening?
You know what? I've got two for you. One, our Napa Cabernet is just fantastic. It's the workhorse of the company, and it's just a stunningly good wine, and it's a great value. It's very affordable, and it's very readily accessible. But I will tell you that one of my favorite wines that we have is something called Generations, and it's a Bordeaux-style blend. It's got Cabernet, Cabernet Franc, Merlot blended into it. It's just soft, it's subtle, and it's just delightful with so many different foods or just all by itself.
Hey, Judd, thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate you taking the time on New Year's Eve. You have a good New Year's Eve. Enjoy, hopefully, a very prosperous 2021 for the Charles Krug family of wines. Judd Wallenbrock, Chief Executive Officer for C. Mondavi & Company, joining us on the phone from Napa, California. And if you think about that part of the world there with the forest fires, it's just been extraordinary. It seems like every year, as Judd was just mentioning, that they've had to deal with some just crazy, crazy fires, and that's really been an impact on what is a crucial industry for that state and for this country, arguably.